Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to the DeLuca Forum and the Wisconsin Institutes for Discovery. I'm Jessica Flack. I'm the co-director of the Center for Complexity and Collective Computation, sponsors this lecture series here in WID. And before I introduce tonight's public lecture and the topic, just a few orders of business. I'd first like to thank some of the people in WID who make tonight happen. So that's Tim Taylor, Laura, Maria Piat, Marian English, Alan, Ruby, Beth Misko, and all of WID's outstanding staff. So thank you guys, thank you so much. And finally, the Center for Complexity and Collective Computation is indebted to John Wiley, who I believe is here tonight, and the Templeton Foundation for their much appreciated financial support. Without this kind of support, this lecture series would not be possible. Now, first a quick question. How many of you are from town? And how many are from the university? Okay, thank you. And an announcement. The announcement is that the last lecture series of the semester will be Wednesday, December 4th. And the speaker is Lauren Ansel Myers, who comes to us from UT Austin. She's going to be talking to us about the science of pandemics. So please join us for that. Okay, so in the introduction to the opening lecture of this series last September, if any of you are here for that, I pointed out that information is one of the potentially most fundamental concepts in science. It's one of those concepts that appears to be relevant to phenomena at a vast range of scales, from quantum mechanics to the origin of life to the evolution of cooperation to the pace and size of cities. So really, you know, covers everything. Now, despite this observation, physics and biology have been dominated by a concern with energy. And consequently, I'd say that we have a pretty good understanding of energy as it's instantiated in thermodynamics, what it is and why it's important. But we're still at a loss when it comes to information. And this includes not only what we mean by the term, but it also means how we formalize it. And there are many formalisms for information that concern uncertainty reduction. That's a particular kind of information that you might be familiar with. Claude Shannon, the mathematician and engineer who came up with some of those concepts. But we still have a very limited sense of those formalisms, and we have a very limited sense of the role that information plays in the evolution of life, and even maybe the evolution of the universe. Many of us believe that biological systems are, in fact, information processing systems, systems that are designed to extract regularities from their environments so they can better adapt. Now, some scientists have gone so far to suggest that biological systems are actually computers, right? So even John von Neumann, the polymath after whom this series is named, was writing a book at the time of his death called The Computer in the Brain. And a lecturer in this series who spoke a couple months ago, Seth Lloyd from MIT, has proposed that the universe itself is a computer. So what's the basis for this kind of claim? In tonight's lecture, Jim Crutchfield, who I will introduce momentarily, is going to suggest that we are on the verge of a new physics of information that explains how information processing has shaped the natural world. Now, a little about Jim. Jim received his BA in physics and mathematics from Santa Cruz and his PhD in physics there as well. He's currently a professor at Davis in physics, and he's the director of the Complexity Science Center. Now, for many years, he was also a professor at the Santa Fe Institute, and that's where David Krakauer and I met him. And I'd say a unifying theme of Jim's research is patterns, what they are, how nature produces them, and how we discover new ones. And he's taken this deep, long-standing interest in patterns, and he's moved it out of the ivory tower into the real world by designing exhibits at places like the Exploratorium in San Francisco, and even events like Burning Man in the Black Rock Desert of Nevada. I should also add that not so long ago, David and I spent a weekend with Jim camping in the Ventana Wilderness above Big Sur, and we also learned there that Jim is a great backcountry cook. So it's a pleasure to welcome him tonight as a friend, a collaborator, and a creative scientist. Thank you.
Thank you. Jessica, thanks for that nice introduction. And not just the personal part, but the part about information. So I'm going to try to talk to you tonight about what information is in several different guises. And the theme of the talk and the way it's organized is kind of a realization I had. I've been starting a new project on information at the nanoscale. And I started going back and looking at some of the historical work on information. And I started to realize there's this very funny proclivity even in physics, right? The study of the inanimate world. These long-standing appeals to intelligence. Well, back in the 17th century, intelligence wasn't a physical thing. It was this kind of strange extra-physical appeal in these arguments, even by physicists and mathematicians who are trying to understand organization in the natural world. And so the way I'm going to talk about information and pattern and structure of the world is to think back historically over these various appeals to intelligence. And these come up as various kinds of demons. I was a little concerned about who might show up for the talk by giving this title. Maybe we can change WID to the Wiccan Intelligent Design Company. The talk is a series of sort of snapshots of as I've sort of read through the historical literature, trying to understand my current project on information at the nanoscale. And it's organized around what I'm going to call three different acts. And so these are going to be kind of snapshots at different points in time. First, we're going to start with celestial mechanics, and then move into the Industrial Revolution, and then finally kind of muse over sort of where we are now. Rumor has it that we're in the age of information. Well, it's been slightly rechristened as big data, a phrase I'm not very happy about. Age of information sounds a little more romantic to me. And I'll try to weave this thread through about how various thinkers, scientists and mathematicians have thought about the role of information, but often in the guise of various kinds of imaginary intelligences and demons. So the first step is you have to go back in this journey to think about where we were in, say, the 1600s or 1700s, this sort of a world dominated by how Newtonian physics colored things. 1776, and I call this Laplace's demon. So part of what I'm going to do here is kind of offload the responsibility of my argument from me to various enlightened predecessors. So here's Laplace's view of the kind of state of the world around, well, him, the way he thought, the way the physical world worked. Pardon me while I read this to you. The present state of the system of nature is evidently a consequence of what it was in the preceding moment. And if we conceive of an intelligence which at a given instant comprehends all of the relations of the entities of this universe, it could state the respective positions, motions, and general affects of all these entities at any time in the past or future. So this is what we've come to call determinism. And this is a wonderfully concise statement of this. Now, there is this ruse, namely, that we have to think about a being that actually can measure the positions of all the molecules and atoms and their current velocities. But the benefit of this, of course, is that this being, with this large amount of data, can then not only predict the future, but also retrodict the past. So the world is deterministic in this view. And also, kind of a benefit here, it's also reversible. That the world, if I look into the future, looks just the same as if I look into the past. I can predict and retrodict equally well, or I shouldn't say me, because I'm a lowly human being, but at least this omniscient intelligence. So this is a slightly odd appeal. I mean, this is, in fact, a quote that comes from a preface to Laplace's book on the calculus of probabilities, because he's got a problem here. He's got a book on probability, but then the world that he's talking about is completely deterministic. There is no chance. So there's a problem. Where does chance come from? This sort of thoroughgoing deterministic view of the world There is no free will. So there are even sort of philosophical and religious implications of this Newtonian view of the physical world. So here's his argument for why there could be uncertainty, unpredictability, surprise, and randomness. But ignorance of the different causes involved in the production of events, as well as their complexity, taken together with the imperfection of analysis, prevents our reaching the same certainty about the vast majority of phenomena. Thus, there are things that are uncertain for us, things more or less probable, and we seek to compensate for the impossibility of knowing them by determining their different degrees of likelihood. So it is that we owe to the weakness of the human mind, oh, you weak little humans, one of the most delicate and ingenious of mathematical theories, the science of chance or probability. So if you were this omniscient being, there would be no mystery for you. Everything would be predictable and retrodictable. It's only because we have a limited sense of the world, a limited conception of the world, a limited time to analyze it, because we're so human that things appear to be random. And so about this time, again, that was 1776, founding of our country, that the physical view of the world was actually kind of broken into two different, what I would call dynamical extremes. Either there were things that were completely predictable. Think of the clock as an example. In fact, this physical system is so predictable, we use it to mark time. Or we have ignorance, characterized by the fair coin flip. And if we look around the world, of course, because we are limited humans, this randomness just occurs because we're ignorant. So rather radical change in this view occurred at the end of the 1800s with the French mathematician Henri Poincare. Actually, what I'm going to quote from is a book that he wrote that was the result of winning a prize to solve what was called the three-body problem. The three-body problem, after actually quite a long period of time by the mathematicians and theoretical physicists of the period, consists of the sun, the earth, and a massless moon, all three bodies constrained to move in the same plane. And it turned out that that's a hard problem to solve. And the king of Sweden had offered a prize to the first mathematician who could solve the problem and actually just prove the obvious fact that when you look up to the heavens, as humans had done for millennia, tens and thousands of millennia, and just seeing that, in fact, the motion of the stars, there were a few curious stars, later called the planets, whose motion was quite predictable. So here we are in 1885 or so, just asking for a solution to this. And Poincare, the senior mathematician he was at the time, submitted the solution to this problem, showing that the three-body problem was completely predictable. And he went to Stockholm and got his prize money. And as part of the prize, the king subsidized publishing the book that contained the manuscript of proving the stability of the three-body problem. Except that as it was going to press, well, the typographer sent a letter to Professor Poincare saying, excuse me, don't mean to bother, we're on kind of a tight production deadline, except I noticed that there was a minus sign here that I couldn't quite rationalize, and far be it from me to correct this. Most of these days kind of think back to when we ever had scientific editors that would help us, but anyway, good old days. And Poincare, you know, please, Professor Poincare, please correct this and send me the updated paragraph or two and we can move forward publishing the book. Poincare went back and looked at this and realized he had made a catastrophic error. Shouldn't have got the prize money, shouldn't have gone to Stockholm, and he repaired to his South France cottage and spent the next 6 months writing a 1,700-page book called New Methods of Celestial Mechanics. I don't recommend reading this. It's kind of hard going. Not many have. Been reissued recently, interestingly enough, but it is worth reading for those even the slightest interest. Go and check it out and read the last few sections, because this is where he discovers that even the three-body problem, these masses interacting, can be inherently unpredictable. It's not because you and I are ignorant and limited. It's because nature inherently, because of its built-in instabilities, creates randomness. So here's how he describes this. But even if it were the case that natural laws had no longer any secret for us, we could still only know the initial situation approximately. If that enabled us to predict the succeeding situation with the same approximation, that is all we require, and we would say that the phenomenon had been predicted, that it is governed by law. But it is not always so. It may happen that small differences in the initial conditions produce very great ones in the final phenomenon. A small error in the former will produce an enormous error in the latter. Prediction becomes impossible, and we have the fortuitous phenomenon. So even if you were Laplace's demon with this omniscient view of the world, the very instabilities built into nature would make it unpredictable. And this we now, and many of you are quite familiar with this, we call deterministic chaos. A kind of wonderfully contradictory phrase, deterministic chaos. And he discovered, back in 1892, that, in fact, it led to this inherent randomness, that there's a deterministic mechanism that amplifies small variations to large scale and makes the world unpredictable. And we now know, and this has been one of the things I've done over many years, that turbulent fluids, many different systems, are deterministically chaotic. So there's kind of a move here. This is the interesting thing. We start with Laplace's demon trying to somehow conceive of this infinite intelligence that can measure all the positions and momenta of the atoms and molecules in the world and try to predict things. And then it's only ignorance and inaccuracy that means we can't predict things as humans, to this replacing this sort of appeal to this ill-defined intelligence with actually a mechanistic phenomenon that actively produces randomness and unpredictability. Okay, so that's the end of the first act, the celestial mechanics. What's so interesting historically is that at kind of the same time, there is this amazing transformation going on in the Industrial Revolution, 1700s to the mid-1800s, where for the first time, humans are able to commandeer and control energy on vast scales, unlike any previous time. Before that time, you wanted a cup, you had to make the cup. You wanted to be warm, you had to go out and find the trees to cut down and or the coal in the mines. So we have this period of innovation, the Industrial Revolution, where there's this amazing improvement in the human condition. The first development of the engines of the Industrial Revolution, these heat engines, were to actually just simply pump water out of coal mines so you could get more coal. Then we turned into locomotives to transport heavy goods or even for human transportation, revolutionized farming, water transport, and even communication through the press. So it's an amazing period where, for the first time, humans realized how to take heat energy and convert it to do useful work so that we have better lives. There's not a thing that we're doing tonight that isn't a consequence of this. It's an amazing transformation. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. It also came with unbelievable amounts of suffering, the decanting of the rural populations into cities, urbanization, close human social networks leading to the rise of disease, class inequality, and political oppression, and so on. So there are many other sort of downsides of the same innovation. Of course, we persisted in this. One of the curious things about this innovation is actually a social innovation, which was in the late 1700s, the British government coming up with the patent system. And there's an interesting analysis of this, several that have been done, that looking at the different kinds of decadal innovation in these heat engines, these steam engines, before and after the innovation of patent law. After patent law, suddenly people realized that they could get some credit for their inventions, and suddenly there's an exponential growth in the improvement in efficiency of steam engines. From a scientific point of view, there's also another interesting aspect of the Industrial Revolution. It wasn't like some physicists sat down, and maybe this is just a terrible fantasy we physicists have about sort of doing things first and then somehow it gets realized. In fact, people were engineering and inventing long before there was a concrete scientific understanding of how these steam engines worked. And people trying different innovations, trying to control these systems and so on, kept running into difficulties and limitations. question was, how do we convert heat energy into useful mechanical work? And the theoretical science actually substantially lagged the engineering innovations and inventions at the time, substantially. In some sense, sort of coming in after the fact and trying to clean things up and make a conceptual whole. And that was this theory of thermodynamics, the theory of heat energy. So one of the most characteristic things about thermodynamic systems is that they are irreversible. This is the typical thing that we see. We have the wine glass, this large-scale object, we drop it on the floor and it breaks into 1,000 pieces. Okay? We do not see the pieces suddenly get together and reassemble themselves into the wine glass. So this is the characteristic of large-scale human experience. Large-scale system with many, many components have this property of irreversibility, and this is the characteristic of these steam engines. Now, if you remember, Laplace's demon made a very clear statement about the fact that at least at the level of measuring the atoms and molecules, the demon could predict and retrodict, or what I said was, the mechanics was reversible. So we've got a problem here. And this was the scientific, intellectual, mathematical problem that was confronting the scientists of the Industrial Revolution. Oh, on the small scale, if I know the positions and momentum of all the molecules, I could predict and retrodict, except on the macro scale, the glass, the wine glass broke. So what's going on here? So the punchline to not, we have many eras to go through here. Let me just sort of mention what came to be described as a second law of thermodynamics is that there are many, many more ways to take the atoms and put them into a disorganized configuration than it is to organize them in such a way that they're a wine glass. Okay, kind of a primitive statement of a wonderful and sometimes seen to be one of the most powerful laws of physics, the second law. And of course, the typical example we use in our physics class is that there are many more ways to take the stuff, socks, out of your chest of drawers and put them on your bed than there are to your son to put them back in your chest of drawers. And that's why your teenager's bedroom is messier. And that's the typical state that you find the system. So one of the premier theorists of developing this theory of thermodynamics was Ludwig Boltzmann. And he had to sort of formalize some of these ideas. So first of all, I've already used the words large scale, the scale of humans. We call that macroscopic. So we can imagine a box of gas molecules bouncing around, and they're macroscopic properties that we're all familiar with. Namely, put your finger on the box, and it has a certain temperature. You try to hold the box, it has a certain pressure. It has a certain volume. There's a certain number of molecules in the box. Those are the parameters that describe the macroscopic large-scale state. The wine glass is a macroscopic state of silicon molecules. The microstate is the listing of all of these detailed molecular positions and velocities. So Boltzmann's reformulation of this idea of the disordered teenage bedroom is this, that the degree of disorganization of a macrostate, so-called the entropy of a macrostate, is the number of microstates consistent with it. So we'll say the teenager's bedroom is disorganized, and maybe some of you would even want to say it has a certain high temperature, but that corresponds to many, many, many different ways of putting the socks and the shoes around the room. Boltzmann also sort of went on to characterize systems when they finally settle down in equilibrium. That state, the state, what state will you find a system in? It's a state that has maximum entropy, or to say it in terms of these microstates, has the most microstates associated. The most ways of realizing it microscopically, that's the state in equilibrium. Moreover, Boltzmann went on to note that for any thermodynamic process, as we're changing the volume or, say, the pressure on a system, the entropy always increases. And there's some caveats here. So that was sort of the picture, the first steps to trying to understand how these steam engines worked, what the fundamental limits on these systems that were commandeering energy for us to do useful work. The problem was, and here's our second sort of character in the play is Maxwell's demon. So James Clerk Maxwell was a physicist contemporary of Boltzmann, and here's a picture with his wife, Catherine. I sort of like this picture because it always reminds me, they did some very interesting work on color perception back in the 1860s when they were both living in London. There was a time when physics wasn't broken into animate and inanimate. People were actually interested in how observers perceive the world. So they did a number of pioneering studies of color perception. But as Maxwell was thinking back through the foundations of thermodynamics, he realized that he could actually thwart this second law, that systems always tended to disorder. And so here's how he describes this. If we conceive of a being, there we go again, of a being whose faculties are so sharpened that he can follow every molecule in its course, shades of Laplace's demon, such a being whose attributes are as essentially finite as our own would be able to do what is impossible to us. Now let us suppose that a vessel is divided into two portions, A and B, and by a division in which there is a small hole, and that a being who can see the individual molecules opens and closes this hole so as to allow only the swifter molecules to pass from A to B, and only the slower molecules to pass from B to A. He will thus, without expenditure of work, raise the temperature of B and lower that of A in contradiction to the second law. In other words, this demon who has this sort of arbitrarily light divider that he can move in and out will allow the red hot molecules through the from A to B and the cold ones from B to A such that at the end he's taken a system in equilibrium in the maximum state of maximum entropy and disorder and separated out to a cold area and a hot area, creating a temperature difference, making the system out of equilibrium. That's not what the second law said. So what's going on here? Well, like Laplace, he was appealing to some being that could measure the positions and momentum of all these molecules. Why is that not possible? What's going on here? How can you thwart the second law? In particular, if such a being existed, you and I can't do this, but maybe such a being existed, you could convert this heat energy to a temperature difference, and then actually from the temperature difference, create work, as we'll describe. So the demon, with this microscopic information, the position of the atoms and molecules and their velocities, could actually create order out of this molecular chaos. And it's just not the case, right, that in looking at the glass, pieces on the floor, they spontaneously start jiggling and reassemble themselves. That process never happens, essentially never, ever happens. So what's going on? What's this mysterious stuff that these demons are working with? Now, with a temperature difference, you can actually go do useful work, right? If I put coal into my steam engine, the wheels turn. So part of the development of thermodynamics is trying to understand these steam engines as thermodynamic cycles. So if you have a temperature difference, a hot reservoir and a cold reservoir, you have a heat flow from hot to cold, and the goal of a heat engine is to steal some piece of this heat flow of heat energy as it goes from hot to cold, such that it can do useful mechanical work. This is the basic idea behind all heat engines. And a famous example of this was due to Sadie Carnot, called the Carnot cycle. And there's a series of steps, heating, expanding, and cooling, that allows a heat engine to extract a certain amount of useful work. In a sense, what's going on, you have this disorganized thermal energy of the molecules. Some fraction of that can be pulled off as organized energy to do useful work, but you still have to dissipate or get rid of the rest of the heat energy. You've created disorganization. So it's very easy for us to convert mechanical energy to heat. There are no limitations on that. Rub your hands together. Mechanical energy, your palms heat up. Okay, there's no thermodynamic limits on that. But you cannot completely convert heat into work. And so this was one of the sort of triumphs of the theory of thermodynamics vis-a-vis steam engines and the empirically observed inefficiency that they had. As I go around the cycle, compressing, heating, cooling, and so on, disorder increases. I'm extracting some piece of useful energy that's very organized part of molecular energy, but I leave behind a more disordered system, and it turns out it takes some energy to exhaust that to return the system, the engine, back to its original state so it can do that same conversion again. That limits the engine efficiency, and Maxwell and others were able to derive why the steam engines could never be perfectly efficient because of this. The key idea in this is this notion of entropy or disorganization, molecular disorganization. There are also some other issues going on here, like actually the second law says entropy always increases, disorder always increases. Well, if that's true, why isn't everything disorganized? In fact, what are you doing here tonight? Why aren't the molecules all jumping around? This would never happen. What's going on? Well, there's sort of a curious thing. Also, in the same period, and this is unfortunately a brief intermission about the biological. It could be several talks long. During the same period of the Industrial Revolution, we have this interesting character, Charles Darwin, trying to understand the origins of biological form. And he introduces this concept of natural selection, survival of the fittest. I have a population of competing individuals, and somehow, through their form, through their behavior, they can replicate more quickly than others. And so, lo and behold, whatever gave rise to how they behave better and what their form is will appear over time in larger proportions in the population. This is undoubtedly the most clever demon of all these demons. It's a way of actually out of sort of randomness and variation, and a full discussion of this, I would have to bring in genetics, mutation, and so on, but we're going to kind of skip over that. The net effect, though, is that this Darwin's demon of natural selection, it ratchets in organization out of randomness. It kind of locks in things that are better. The differential replication. If I have longer legs and can run faster and don't get eaten by tigers, there's going to be more of me in the next generation. So it actually locks in organization. It's completely mechanistic, and it's an inherent dynamic. It just boils down to who can out-replicate other people. And a response to a bunch of sort of extra physical other notions about the origins of life and different species. And it's very analogous in a way in terms of the structure of the argument, the role that natural selection plays vis-a-vis the ideas he was competing against, the way that Poincare's demon replaces a mechanistic demon, inherent instability in the physics of the world, replaces Laplace's notion of an omniscient being. And natural selection has a huge burden to bear. I mean, this is just a quick example of the scales of biological nature. Actually, it's 10 orders of magnitude, unbelievable. From atoms, we have molecules, very sophisticated biomolecules like DNA, macromolecules that are functional proteins and enzymes, organelles, cells, and so on, this huge hierarchy of structure and pattern. So a lot of biology has been focused on this first question, kind of phenomenology. How many different kinds of biological organization are there? This is a question that greatly exceeds this sort of simple notion of natural selection, but somehow natural selection is implicated in locking in these structures somehow. What mechanism does this organization and pattern appear? Are these really, I put these pictures down here, but are these different levels of biological nature actually objective? Or is it just the fact that, say, well, I'm in a university here, so we just have different disciplines and we like to focus on different things? Or are these really different levels of organization in nature? And why does nature organize? Is it some big optimization problem? To glory in God, to make more efficient use of energy, or what? What's going on here? And probably even more basic than all of those, we can't make progress on any of those questions in a fundamental way until we address this question of what is pattern, what is organization? I keep using these words in kind of an informal sense, but at some point we have to buckle down and say what we mean. Now, I gave you some idea about sort of the role of information, but actually the notion of information, pattern, and organization are now completely intertwined. And so that'll be the third act here. Talk about our current age, the age of information. So what's going on? What is information? What in the world is information? So this is a short little movie, and it, for me, encapsulates almost all the puzzles of the talk, although it's a very, very simple example. So bear with me, it's about a minute long, but I want you to take detailed notes about what's happening.
Isn't it nice when things just work?
Okay, so first I have to apologize for the product placement, but I like this video. Well, partly because when I show this to people, people laugh. Do you know why you were laughing? There's actually something about what I'm talking about that is important to why you were laughing, because you were trying to predict or you were surprised at a couple stages. And different people laugh at different things, so I guess we have different aesthetics for contingency and for causality and cause and effect. Some things are more or less surprising, and so things kind of change. Okay, now of course, as I asked you to do, you're supposed to take detailed notes. What did we just see? We saw a rather long chain of cause and effect. Yes? Well, my count yesterday, and this varies, think about how close attention I pay. It's about 60 different interactions, and you know what I mean by interaction. You know, the muffler comes around and hits the valve that rolls and hits another valve. So I mean individual interactions. Now, if you count the number of interactions, it's about 60. So let's just imagine, okay, and I'm a little bit putting on my hat as a physicist. I look at this, I'm trying to explain using basic physical principles, which means does an energy accounting and bookkeeping of that cause and effect chain explain what happened? Well, model, 60 interactions, let's just say the amount of energy in each interaction was transferred was just 10%, 1/10 each time. That was 60 interactions. That means at the end of the chain, the amount of the initial energy that started it off, all that's left is 10 to the minus 60. 10, 1 over 10 with 60 zeros behind it. This is far below thermal agitation because that was all done at room temperature or quantum levels. The conclusion, energy is not an explanation for what happened. So what's going on? You saw it happen. Those interactions weren't so unfamiliar. So the claim is that was information. The consistent thing that's moving through each one of those interactions is information. Now, there are curious things that happen, of course, in terms of energy. For example, think of the ramp where the wheels rolled up. Okay, you should have gone, okay, what's going on there? That's actually pretty easy. The filmmakers who had to, they took several hundred tries to get that to work, that whole sequence. They positioned the wheels on the ramp with an offset weight, but just poised so that any small little variation, think of Poincare, could tip it over and then release that energy and it would roll up the hill. That's true at every stage through that chain of cause and effect. The systems are poised and ready. So it's not actually the raw amount of energy that's driving it through, like one billiard ball hitting another. It's actually instability. And the way we describe the transfer of instability, the unleashing of these, is through information. So this has a long, this idea of information has a long but recent history. In fact, we already saw this picture of Claude Shannon. And in 1958, he published a very famous, beautifully short paper. I wish I could write so concisely, called The Mathematical Theory of Communication. It's kind of, a wonderful conceit. But presumably tonight, I'm communicating to you. This guy's got a mathematical theory of that? Whoa. But actually, what he does is he says, through a few, you know, kind of introductory paragraphs in a section or two, information is surprise. And he writes down a mathematical expression for the degree of surprise in random events and develops a theory. Now, what I'm going to talk about tonight is just information itself and different kinds of information. In fact, the thing that we are very indebted to Shannon for is not so much this concept of information, but in fact, the engineering side of his theory. So what he was able to show is in a communication system, he was working at Bell Labs, after all, in the 40s, and they were in the business of having humans communicate to humans. He showed that using this quantitative definition of information, that you could, in fact, over even a noisy telephone line, exactly transmit a signal with no errors. Tonight, we're surrounded by technology that uses that idea. Did anyone download a MP3 file today? Information transmission, the internet, error control protocols, the video compression, all of these things are based on what's called Shannon's second theorem, that you can do error-free transmission over noisy communication channels. So this is the engineering and kind of operational side of information. But what we've been doing in physics is thinking about what kinds of information are embedded in the real world and trying to understand that there are different kinds of information, somewhat in parallel to the original program of physics. The world is full of energy. There are different kinds of energy. There's kinetic energy, there's gravitational potential energy, there's chemical energy, and so on. And those kinds of energies get transduced. So what we've been doing in this physics of information is trying to think about what kinds of information are produced in the natural world, in the physical world, that can be stored there, that can be transduced from one to another. And so we start with Shannon's original mathematical theory of communication to think about this. Now, probably the easiest definition that's kind of self-contained, that's some ways captures a lot of the subtlety of Shannon's notion of surprise is due to Gregory Bateson, a mentor of mine at Santa Cruz. He called information a difference that makes a difference. So now think back to that causal chain of events in the movie. There was a little difference that made a difference, and then they caused another event further down the chain. So it's not only just difference, not only surprise, but it also has impact. So there's kind of an interesting semantic aspect to Bateson's definition. Gregory Bateson, famous anthropologist, husband of Margaret Mead, worked in anthropology for a long time. Now, since a little bit to at least acknowledge the namesake of the lecture series, I should mention a little anecdote. When Shannon was first developing his mathematical theory of communication, he had this quantitative definition of surprise or information. And von Neumann said, oh, you should call it entropy. You should call it entropy, just like Boltzmann called the degree of disorder in thermodynamic quantity, call that entropy. Because if you're ever in an argument, no one understands entropy and you'll always have the upper hand. And that is unfortunately kind of true. Even today, those of us working in this area, vocabulary, you can really stub your toe on it. So kind of prophetic and somewhat cantankerous. Interestingly, just 10 years after Shannon introduces this quantitative measure of surprise in communication systems to think about engineering communication systems, the Russian, Soviet at the time, mathematician Andrei Kolmogorov basically lock, stock, and barrel picked up Shannon's notion of surprise to describe how chaotic Poincare's systems were. mathematicians had known for since the late, 1890s that physical systems had inherent instabilities. So Kolmogorov borrowed Chan's notion of surprise to describe how small little variations are actively amplified by these nonlinear deterministic chaotic systems. So you can imagine here preparing a system in a particular set of configurations, but then due to the very inherent dynamics, that small variation grows to large scale. Whatever information you had about this is now lost. The system can be anywhere in this. So this is what Kolmogorov called the entropy rate of the chaotic system, and it allowed a number of important problems in mathematics to be solved. But practically, we can now talk about one system being more or less chaotic than another in terms of how much information this system creates. How much microscopic uncertainty, perhaps it's degrees of freedom we don't have control over, how rapidly that information is manifest up to macroscopic scale. So randomness was quantified. Physical randomness is quantified by Kolmogorov's borrowing Shannon's notion of communication. Okay, so that's information, but that doesn't really address what we were talking about when I showed you the hierarchy of biological structure. So what is a pattern? What is organization? Actually, information and organization are intimately related. But just to remind ourselves, here are some of my favorite patterns. Nature, it seems, likes to make patterns. So this is a fluid flow experiment. There's actually a cylinder here. Water's flowing from left to right. And there are four different experiments with the velocity from left to right increasing as you go down. And this instability, a wake occurs, and you have these vortices, so-called von Karman vortex street. This is an example. We're looking down on a Petri dish. You pour in these reagents discovered by two Russian chemists, Belousov and Zabotinsky, and you wait for about 2 or 3 minutes, and suddenly the concentration of ions starts to oscillate, and nearby oscillations start to synchronize, and after a while, what you have are these traveling waves and spiral patterns. This another Petri dish, except this is bacteria, and the nasty experimental biologist has put in some toluene. They get mad, and they all sort of run away together in these synchronous waves. This one is an interesting example of pattern. It sort of looks like the vascular system of a plant leaf. It's not. Take a piece of plastic and stretch it, and you get this self-similar but random series of channels on top, building on top of each other. And also, it goes on and on. I mean, there are dozens of examples. So what's going on here? What are patterns? I mean, at least intuitively, there's some sense that there is some organization here. Patterns even have, I'm told, a social role. The ponies find out, can detect who their mom is by the stripes, the random stripes. So what's a pattern? So here's a definition. So this is a quote from the Argentinian writer Jorge Luis Borges. These ambiguities, redundancies, and deficiencies recall those attributed by Dr. Franz Kuhn to a certain Chinese encyclopedia entitled Celestial Emporium of Benevolent Knowledge. On those remote pages, it is written that animals are divided into A, those that belong to the emperor, B, embalmed ones, C, those that are trained, D, suckling pigs, E, mermaids, F, fabulous ones, G, stray dogs, H, those that are included in this classification, very important, I, those that tremble as if they were mad, J, innumerable ones, K, those drawn with a very fine camel's hair brush, L, others, M, those that have just broken a flower vase, and N, those that resemble flies from a distance. This, I submit to you, is a fine definition of the pattern animal. Now, you are also laughing. This is kind of different than the movie. Why were you laughing? Because it doesn't really capture in a kind of concise and compact way what we mean by a pattern. There's something about when we're describing the pattern of nature, something around us, that somehow the description kind of captures the modularity, as they say, cleaves the meat between the bones. This is obviously this weird scattershot to try to capture what is a pattern. So this is one of the things I've been studying for far too long. What is a pattern? And I won't go into sort of the mathematical underpinnings of this, but just tell you some of the results and how we now view how we can take Shannon's definition of information and use that to start talking about and actually measuring the degree of patternedness in the world. And we now look at the natural world in terms of a spectrum, where you can go from the completely predictable to the completely random, and there's this intermediate range where the degree of patternedness occurs. Sometimes we see this in what we call systems that exhibit phase transition or critical phenomena. So the schematic picture would be, imagine I have a system that I can have a control knob on it. I can change the temperature. I'm varying the Shannon information, Kolmogorov, Sinai entropy, or the thermodynamic entropy across some spectrum from predictable to unpredictable. And this patternness is maximized in the middle, this middle ground. So probably the best way to explain this, in lieu of equations, since it's after dinner, is actually to go back to the philosopher Alfred North Whitehead. Interestingly, these quotes are not about a physical system or a chemical system, but actually thinking about us and human organization. But I think the quotes capture very nicely this idea of complexity as being maximized in the middle ground between order and randomness. So here he's talking about social organization. The social history of mankind exhibits great organizations in their alternating functions of conditions for progress, of contrivances for stunting humanity. The history of the Mediterranean lands and of Western Europe is the history of the blessing and the curse of political organizations, of religious organizations, of schemes of thought, of social agencies for large purposes. The moment of dominance prayed for, worked for, sacrificed for by generations of the noblest spirits marks the turning point where the blessing passes into the curse. Some new principle of refreshment is required. The art of progress is to preserve order amid change and to preserve change amid order. Life refuses to be embalmed alive. The more prolonged the halt in some unreleased system of order, the greater the crash of the dead society. I'm certainly thinking back to what Kolmogorov went through in 1989, back in the collapse of the Soviet Union here. So this is a temporal picture. He's trying to describe at a very large, maybe even kind of abstract level, the patternedness and organization and the sort of periodic, almost ecological successional notion of how human organizations work through this. First, the benefit and the wonder, and exactly the things that you were going for that come back to get you. Here's another example of the same idea, talking about art, the kind of evolution of aesthetics. The same principle is exhibited by the tedium arising from the unrelieved dominance of fashion and art. Europe, having covered itself with treasures of Gothic architecture, entered upon generations of satiation. These jaded epochs seem to have lost all sense of that particular form of loveliness. It seems as though the last delicacies of feeling require some element of novelty to relieve their massive inheritance from bygone system. Order is not sufficient. What is required is something much more complex. It is order entering upon novelty, so that massiveness of order does not degenerate into mere repetition, and so that novelty is always reflected upon a background of system. This is our conundrum. You don't want to be at the extremes. We're constantly navigating this middle ground. The structure we see around us, the complexity in organization, is the product of exactly this tension between order and regularity and randomness. And I hope that's what's been going on tonight. Think about language. Right? Language, it's a system. It's sort of evolved. It's a product of all sorts of things, but certainly human evolution and some sort of exterior goal to communicate something. You and I have to share a certain amount of orderedness, namely a vocabulary and a syntax, things like that. We have to share that. That's predictable. However, if I just start randomly generating things, start speaking in Swahili, which I don't know, and I presume most of you don't, you wouldn't understand what I was saying. So I can't just randomly generate stuff. It wouldn't be understandable to you, or at least not interesting. Right? So language as a system is actually poised exactly in this middle ground. You need the order so there's a substrate so you can understand what I'm saying. However, if you knew exactly what I was going to say, you wouldn't have showed up tonight, right? I hopefully am saying something new, novel, that you're going to take away. Not so predictable if you showed up, but not so random and so novel that you don't understand it. That's my goal, to try to tell you something new, to help you discover a new pattern, a new way of thinking about things that you haven't heard before. So that's the sort of role of this middle ground, and I'm arguing for a kind of dynamical interplay that many natural and human systems are constantly moving back and forth between these two extremes, and somehow we mostly live in this middle ground. That's how we see the world, that's how we discover new patterns, that's how we give them meaning. Okay, so now to kind of start to wrap things up here, a little reprise. So think back to the first couple acts, right? There's some basic lessons that I'd say maybe nonlinear mathematics and physics in the 20th century have given us, namely simple systems like the three-body problem can be quite complicated, inherently unstable and unpredictable. There's a natural mechanism through which the natural world produces information and surprise for us. On the other hand, the whole world isn't just random. Nature also makes patterns and structure. So complicated system, many components, actually can be quite organized. And complexity and organization sort of actually kind of come from the dance, the tension between those two tendencies. And you can sort of go back, think through the sort of where on the spectrum the different demons are here, Laplace's versus Poincare's, Maxwell's versus Darwin's demons. And in all of these, and this is maybe me playing a little bit the historian of science, which I shouldn't do, I should just go back to do my physics, is it seems like in these earlier periods, this appeal to an intelligence, an omniscient intelligence, to Maxwell's being, intelligent being, they're really trying to talk about information and pattern, right? Information is the currency that these demons are working in. Maxwell's demons sorting the molecules to put them in hot and cold partitions. And that information becomes amplified through inherent instabilities and then gets stored as the patterns we see. So let me pull a couple threads together here. So demons, even in science, they're sort of the repository. They kind of embody our fears and our limitations. Right? We imagine the, you know, Laplace's demon. It's this godlike character. And there has been progress. There have actually been these exorcisms of these demons over time, moving from mystery, beings we can barely imagine, to mechanism. We go from the omniscient Laplacian demon to Poincare's, oh no, randomness is just inherent in nature, mechanistic, going from Maxwell to Darwin. And in fact, as one goes back and looks at the kind of, it's almost the prefaces, it's the first few paragraphs in scientific papers where people are trying to get you on board with the way they're analyzing a problem, where these kind of appeals to extraphysical intelligence and demons sort of appear. And there are many others, going from Maxwell to Leo Szilard's, sort of exercising Maxwell's demon, showing that it actually is consistent with the second law, going from the logical foundations of mathematics and what's called the incompleteness to Turing's giving a mechanistic expression, mechanistic demon, that can do all possible computations, and also more recently going to think about the interplay between these Maxwell-like demons and how much coupling to energy and energy dissipation is required to get a certain amount of information done. And all of these, in some sense, writ kind of large and maybe with a fuzzy pair of glasses, intelligence is the issue. And it was a little bit surprising to me as I started to think about information on the nanoscale to go back and read these earlier things and see this kind of common appeal and to realize that, in fact, what they're talking about really is information and information processing. So it's kind of an indirect allusion to some of the work we've been doing in the last 10 years, much of it happening at the Santa Fe Institute, hopefully continuing on here at WID, there is this notion that I've introduced to try to bring these things together, which I call intrinsic computing. I guess Seth Lloyd talked about the entire universe as a computer. I mean every particular process, not writ on the large scale, but in fact every process in nature is doing some type of information processing. And we ask three questions. And these are questions that you can ask of the, you know, roughly idling engine in your car on a cold morning or a waterfall. How much history does a system remember? In what architecture is that information stored, the historical information stored, and how is that stored information used to produce new behavior? And this is the way we're starting to develop a physics of information, looking at different kinds of physical systems, realizing they have different kinds of information, just like in the days of yore, we realized there were different kinds of energy. It's interesting to think back. You know, these days, it's like most of my physics colleagues go, information, that's not part of physics. And then you go back, you know, it's so ill-defined, it's kind of subjective, surprise to you, may not be surprised to me. And then you go back to the 1600s and 1500s and realize long debates about what kinetic energy was and whether it should be proportional to the velocity or the velocity squared. That's the difference between momentum and kinetic energy. And that was a debate, a debate for a long period of time. And so that's sort of where we are right now with this physics of information. There are different kinds of information. My particular approach is to look at different kinds of nonlinear complex systems and try to answer these three questions quantitatively to discover the different kinds of information and how they play a role in describing the complexity and organization of natural systems. So these historical appeals to intelligence, this is kind of a working conjecture, which I hope you don't mind my sharing, is that those historical appeals to intelligence were really appeals to how nature or the thermodynamic system or other systems were actually doing intrinsic computation, that every process can be thought of. Maybe not very interesting. This is certainly a different notion of computation than what you're used to, what I'm used to. You know, for me, this laptop here, I fill in a bunch of numbers in my spreadsheet, I hit return, and I owe, you know, the IRS $1,372. That's not even useful computation, is it? Well, I guess it is for the IRS. So that's the familiar notion of computation. What I'm suggesting is a different way of thinking about computation. If you like, it's everything is storing some part of its history and processing that and sharing that information, communicating that. So it's a different view of sort of the fabric of the natural world. And in fact, it's almost a way of thinking about how intelligence, again, could be very simple, is embedded in the natural world. So the way I summarize that, the way nature is structured, the patterns that we see, is how nature computes. So to parse that phrase, you have to, first of all, like I said, relax a little bit your notion of what computing is, and just imagine that physical, biological, chemical, and social systems at some different level are moving to this middle ground and storing and processing information. In fact, I think what we do naturally in our minds, what our minds are most characteristically, are pattern discovery engines. We're constantly trying to look around and make sense of the world, and this view sort of increase the intrinsic computation that we see in the environment around us, or more radically, just that the very dynamic of nature in its physical, biological laws is doing pattern discovery, that the world is becoming more patterned and structured over time. Well, you've been very patient. Thank you so much. So I'm happy to take some questions. I know I covered a lot of territory, a lot of different ideas, but hopefully one or two things stuck.
Jim?
Yeah.
Hi, thank you for speaking. With the kind of the Rube Goldberg commercial there, my understanding of the explanation was that since there were so many activities in sequence and the initial energy would have diminished so much, and we know that it wouldn't have been enough to start a car at the end, then we had to think that we had to kind of impute that information was what had done this. But if we had filmed this commercial on the moon and we had no gravity, it wouldn't have worked. At various points along the way, gravity or other forces, who knows what, are shooting energy into the system, are they not?
Right.
I guess I just didn't understand that.
Yeah, the energy plays a role, but actually in the intentional design of the filmmakers, such that they've made a path through the space of interaction, such that these things are all exquisitely contingent. And so when I say energy doesn't work, well, I can't come up with a quantitative study for that. I'm sort of substituting in this notion of information for as a way of describing this contingency. Just like Shannon's notion of surprise. It's like it's in some sense before and after the interaction, one system is greatly surprised by the other. Now I could redesign the system on the moon such that that would happen, or some analogous thing could happen. Maybe many of those particular effects wouldn't work, but you can still design contingent systems like that.
Returning to your idea of humans as pattern discovery engines, would you then reimagine the theory of evolution, that our success, quote unquote, is the mechanism for moving evolution forward has been pattern discovery, and as successful, hopefully, pattern discoverers, that's why where we are.
Yeah, that's the basic idea. If you take that seriously, there's some hard work to do to try to make that quantitative and precise, but that's the overall picture that. And I also don't want to, you can change the circumstances of a biological system so it doesn't necessarily keep accumulating more and more structure. There are also examples of de-evolution where things simplify. But okay, take that aside. The basic idea, sort of the best of all possible worlds, is that when there is a mutation that leads to the organism being able to swim faster away from whatever, that gets locked in by first differential replication. And then the mutations are sort of taking advantage of the nonlinear pattern-forming aspect of nature to make the longer legs or so on, right? So it's actually an interaction between natural selection locking things in and the very basic pattern-forming fodder that's offered up to evolution as kind of a palette to then lock in. Now, which particular happens? Well, there are different schools of thought. Some it's completely random, some it's kind of channeled, and so on. And then you start getting into the very detailed kind of debates within evolutionary theory. Is it historical events? They're all frozen accidents. Is it really, actually, no, they're mechanical, energetic, pattern form constraints, or it actually is just sort of selection and local adaptation. So they're kind of different schools of thought, and fortunately, at the Santa Fe Institute, I was allowed to watch as an outsider as the main thinkers got to debate this. So I ended up with a sort of outside, somewhat agnostic view.
In terms of the patterns that have come and gone and that we know about, do you have a sense of meta patterns? And in particular, meta patterns about the directionality of this computation.
It's, in some ways, it's patterns all the way down, right? Kind of depends on the level of the question. So think about, just as an example, the two quotes from the philosopher Alfred North Whitehead. At one level, the first quote was about social dynamics, and then he switches to talk about fashion, which presumably is on a shorter time scale, but co-occurring with these larger scale social movements through organization and disorganization. So these things are happening all the time. And you can even start talking about, once you can identify at different scales where the information patterns are stored, is there even cross-level interaction between them? So that's some of the mathematical work we do, is trying to define information flow, not in storage, not within one level, but also across levels too.
Maybe one more question.
So I have a question about the speed of information.
Wait for the microphone here. Nobody else can hear you. Sorry.
My question is about the speed of information, and implicit in that is the concept of time, right? And even from the very beginning, there's this being that can predict the next state, right? And so there's some unit of time that occurs after. And entropy says that it always increases over time, right? So how is the notion of time embedded in this? And why does it always go the same direction?
Right.
And how does that relate to the maximum speed of information?
Yeah, so the question is about, it's a multi-level question. Right, so the direction of time, this is in fact, it's even kind of in the last year or two been picked up again. It was kind of unpopular for a while, and so my particle physics colleagues are now talking about this again. The most typical way you hear people discussing this is in terms of the second law, namely Boltzmann's notion that and it's a little bit dicey here for me to use the word disorder, but I was trying to simplify things, that in a closed system, however I prepare the system, it's going to move to a macroscopic state that can be realized with more microscopic configurations, or quantitatively, the entropy increases. And then people associate that increase in entropy as defining the direction of time. However, Laplace comes in to kind of kick you in the butt on this, because if I went and turned the molecule velocities around, I can actually have a system decrease in entropy. So that's not a good argument. So it's a really interesting argument. You have to be careful how you frame it. I'm not convinced that anyone has a good argument, in particular in terms of the second law. I think that's too easily contradicted by simple examples. So in my classes on sort of the nonlinear dynamics and chaos, I show what we call the dot spreading experiments. I start a bunch of particles off, and I can show that either they start close and spread out, or I start them spread out and they collapse. Those are entropy increasing and entropy decreasing. So you have to be very careful about how you frame it to make a consistent argument about a direction of time. As far as I'm concerned, no one has actually answered the question yet. Although that doesn't stop people from suggesting proposals for this. So it's a great question.
Well, thank you all for coming. Let's thank Jim.